Hello everybody, welcome back to another episode of Multipurpose with Lakshit. So today I have Nikhil. So a lot of people watching this would know him very well. But anyway, just giving an introduction. So Nikhil is the founder, co-founder and the CEO of Yuva and the member of Global Advisory Board of Goalkeepers at Gates Foundation. So yeah, thank you Nikhil for being here. It's my pleasure having you. Thank you very much.
I'm very excited. I'm so excited that you are doing a podcast at such a young age of your life. It makes me very excited when I see young people doing well and, you know, putting themselves out there. This is what we need in our country. We need young people to be sharper, to kind of put their voices out there, put their stories out there. So I'm really excited. Thank you for having me here.
It's my pleasure. Thank you. Thank you for that appreciation. It means a lot to me. So yeah, first thing before starting, I would ask to you, is like if you can speak about yourself and what you do.
As you yourself said, I am the co-founder and CEO of Yuva. That's a lot of my identity right now. I've started the company about a couple of years ago. It's a youth media and a platform that aims to empower young people, that aims to listen to the stories of young people and represent them, and hopefully create content that makes them feel less alone. I have been all my life, I have worked in the entertainment industry. Before this, I was with Hindustan Times and I was with MTV India. Then I was with Yashraj Films. I made a bunch of web shows over there. I produced, out of the first 6-7 web shows in India, 4 were produced by me. Bang Baja Bharat, Lady Zoom, Man's World, Papu Baba. I've also been a teacher for 7 years. So I used to teach in a college in Bombay called Jain College. And now I'm an entrepreneur. I'm now trying to use my understanding of content and my understanding of the issues of young people and trying to bring them together for a platform that hopefully helps and impacts the lives of young people. That's really what I'm doing right now.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. Yeah. So why, your company focuses on, young people. So why did this idea come to your mind, start a company for young people? What was the idea?
So I'll be honest, I have always felt more comfortable among young people than I felt among older people right from the time I was in college, because I have seen that young people have a lot of hope. They have a lot of energy. They have a lot of passion. They're not cynical. They're not... like, for example, and I'll be honest, okay? I've been thinking of starting a podcast for a year now. I'm double your age, and you are at 16 and you've just decided to go for it. And that's what I admire about young people. I feel like, they're go-getters. They have the enthusiasm of doing things and hopefully impacting the world as well. Whereas I feel like older people are very cynical and or at least get very, like, too restricted by their age to do new and interesting things. And I think that, the company was particularly started because of two reasons. One, as a professor at Jain College, I started listening to a lot of my students. I was a different kind of professor. I never used to just talk. I used to also listen a lot. Instead of teaching, I think I've learned a lot from my students for 7 years. And everything that I heard, I realized that there's a lot of issues that young people have in the world that we live in today, and unfortunately they're not being addressed, because content creators and entertainment platforms don't really understand young people. So that was one thing. And second, I also feel that young people have I really think that if the world is going to change and become better, it's going to be often because of young people. And and I think that more older people need to help lead the way, help young people lead the way, help them, guide them and mentor them if possible in creating a better world for us. Because I don't think old people have been trying for a long time and failing at it. So I have my bets on young people for making the world a better place.
Okay. Okay. And how do you think young people are making the world a better place? How do you think younger generations are able to make this world a better place?
Well, you tell me, Lakshit. Do you think that young people today are making the world a better place?
I don't know how to say this. It's my thoughts, but I don't know. Like, do you agree with it or not? But I think yes. Young people are making this world a better place, but not everybody is able to, you know, do it. There are some which I don't know. I don't know if you agree, but I feel it that everybody is not able to process. You know, a better kind of thoughts which everybody has. Like accepting everybody, accepting every race, accepting every gender. There are some who can, there are some who cannot. You know, accepting new ideas, accepting things like veganism, and you know, understanding eating non-veg is not good. Saving the environment is important. These kind of things. So it's a mixed what do you say?
Yeah.
Thought I have in my mind.
Yeah. So my answer is exactly. See, the fact that you are even thinking about these things,
okay,
makes you a better person than what I was at my age.
Okay.
I wasn't thinking of making the world at your age the better place. You know, that wasn't my concern. My concern was ki mujhe girlfriend mil jaye life ke andar, mere exams mein achhe marks aa jaye, mere ko my parents kind of hopefully understand me, and I maybe someday get into like a nice college and enjoy my life after that. That is the only concerns I had as a young person.
Okay.
But given the fact that today's young people are even thinking about these things, caring about these things, I think young people today are far more empathetic, feel far more than any other generations before. And I feel that they at least try to understand what is going on, even if they're not actively trying to do anything to do better, which is also pretty great when you think about it. If individually, every young person is just making that attempt at becoming a better person by himself, you are making the world a better place collectively. You know, so I don't think a lot of older people have had that introspection. So I'm just quite happy that this is a generation that cares so deeply about so many issues of the world. So I that's why I think that, you know, that you are and will be making the world a better place.
Okay. So what were your challenge? Like, what were your major problems when you started VIUR? Like, as in company, what were your problems?
So the thing is, when you start a company and as an entrepreneur, Akshit, the problems are, you don't foresee any problems. You kind of think that this is my idea, this is my baby, I'm going to set the rules, so everything's going to be great for sure. Except as you go along, you start realizing that creating a company in itself is a very big issue.
Yeah.
It's not easy. You know, there are, outside of course, accounting and management things, which are structural, infrastructural issues that you have to take care of. There's also culture. You have to make sure that there is a bunch of people who feel safe in that place. They trust the founder as much as they trust each other. There is a positive work culture where everyone is helpful and warm and supportive, and at the same time are working hard, you know, because those are the demands of any company, and particularly that for a startup.
Yeah.
You obviously have, when a company has to start growing, it has to start making money. Mm-hmm. With making money comes a lot of big issues as to how are you getting that money? Are there compromises to be made from the core values that you have? And if you're not making those compromises, how are you ensuring that salaries are being paid? You know, so there are a lot of issues. And I think that a lot of the companies, it takes, I think, about a year and a half, 2 years for a lot of companies to find their value system, their core value system. And if you are able to get through that, with a bunch of people who are supportive and encouraging, and a good core team, I think then you have great chances of success. But I think every entrepreneur faces this in year one, year and a half. It's never how you imagine it. You always think that, you know, starting a company is going to be easier than doing a job. It's not true at all. When you have a job, you can actually take a day off. You can, if you screw up, you can actually, or if you don't like people there, or if things are not going well, you can just move away and do another job. You know, but with your own company, you don't have that luxury. You can't just shut down a company because I had a bad day, or you can't just take a week long break because I'm not feeling too well, so I just want to take a week long break. You have to be accountable all times. So yes, those are some of the challenges that I think come with every company, honestly.
Okay. And do you regret starting your own company and you know, leaving your job?
No, I don't regret it for sure. You know, I think when you have See, I'll tell you, when you start working, you start realizing, Lakshit, that nothing is going to be easy. Okay, everything is going to be hard. No matter which company you work at, no matter which job you do, whether you start your own company, things are going to be hard. Because if you have to, if you're honest, if you are passionate, if you care about the work you do, you know, and if you obviously need to earn money, all of these things, you know, you're not just working in a silo. You're working with a lot of other people. You're working under rules and regulations of the company. You're working on goals and mission statements set by other people. You know, when you're working for some other company, and when it's to your own, of course, you have to set these rules and then follow them. So it's always going to be hard. It's never going to be easy. You know, and I've done now 3 jobs. I was with Hindustan Times, MTV, Yashraj Films before I started UVA. And everywhere I had tough times. I had some really fun times as well where I was really enjoying my work. But sometimes got, you know, things were not working out. So it was quite difficult. But at least when you start a company, I have felt that at least the pursuit you have is for a when even when it is tough, it is in the pursuit of something you love. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not just to make somebody else money. It's not just to get a good salary or to get like a bigger check home. It is truly to do something that you care about deeply. Mm-hmm. And so when you have the good times, then you realize that the hard times are like far more worth it when you start something of your own. Okay. So yeah, I mean, starting your own company comes with challenges, but I do. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll never have regrets of starting something of my own.
Okay. And do you sometimes feel bad? Like, as you said, you first were working in media, then you became a teacher, and then you got into starting your own company. So do you sometimes feel scared, or are there a weird thoughts in your mind that would this company even last, because I'm changing my career constantly, you know? I just wanted to ask this question, you know, like, did this thought come to your mind that I'm just juggling my careers, with this company last, and would I be able to, you know, keep it going on?
That's a very deep question. You have pointed out that I'm not very good at keeping my attention in one place very long, which is very fair. I take the criticism and I agree to it. I'm not someone who I'm constantly someone who wants to do other things, who wants to do more things, who want to diversify. You know, I it's very hard for me to just do one thing and do that forever. That's 100% the kind of, I'm a multitasker, and I enjoy participating in as many different things as possible. Having said that, you know, see, the unique thing of having a company like UVA is that it is giving me the opportunity to do multiple things, because I have the opportunity to scale it in a way I want. So if today I wanted to be a content company, which is what it is right now, I'm contributing there and I'm developing that content. But I also wanted to make sure, like, as a professor, I also want to make sure that I wanted to reach out to young people offline. So we started something called the UVA Roadshow, where we went across India. We went to over 100 colleges over the last 2 years. We've come to Bangalore also. We've come to many colleges in Bangalore, you know, including PESET, including, which one was... I think Shri Ramaji, I think college. There was Jain University. There was Brindavan. I've had a lovely time at Brindavan. So I've gone to many colleges in Bangalore as well. You know, so I have, and of course, if tomorrow I want to do something else, I have the possibility as you are to be able to get there. And that's the most beautiful part of your company, especially if it's a company that's got a broad, it's got a deep philosophy. But a broad sense of what it could be. And that's how companies scale also, right? Like, it doesn't have to be, I'm not limited by what UVA needs to be. I think UVA needs to impact young people. UVA needs to solve the problems of young people. Okay. But those problems don't just exist in content. They exist in different spheres. So whenever I feel like, okay, I want to contribute in this particular part of, you know, the problem that exists, then I can always move towards that. Having said that, you know, I think every one of us shouldn't be doing work worried about how long it would last. You know, we should be doing work thinking about whether or not it is giving you meaning. You know, and if it is giving you meaning, you know, you should work at it. You know, and of course there are going to be hard times. You know, of course there's going to be good times and bad times. But if as I said, if it's in the pursuit of something you love and something that you find meaningful, you will not care too much about the bad things. You'll always move towards good times. And when you kind of feel like a meaning nahi hai, okay, And it's a tough day that happens when you start realizing that, okay, maybe this is all I can do now. I don't think, as hard as I work or as much as I love what I'm doing, I don't think I'm finding meaning or fulfillment in this. Then you take different decisions. You know, so and you are the opportunity, of course, of being a founder of a company is that you can always be the founder of a company without being the CEO of that company, right? Mm-hmm. Like, while I'm the CEO of the company right now, maybe 7-10 years down the line, whenever I feel like, okay, you know what, I want to now put my work only into, meeting young people and teaching, you know, then I can appoint another CEO and I can take a larger role where I'm just looking at, as a founder, I'm making sure the value systems of the company are the same. Yeah. But there are different people who are running the company. So that's the advantage of having a company. But as you said, I try not to think in those terms. I always try to think in terms of, you know, am I finding meaning in what I'm doing right now?
Yeah. I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings or, you know, I hurt.
No, of course. I did not. Please don't say sorry, man. I'm really enjoying this conversation. Don't apologize. You're asking some really good questions. They're coming from your heart, and I'm very happy to hear them. So don't worry. Please feel free. Please be candid and ask me these questions. I'm really enjoying this conversation.
Okay, great. No problem. So what was why did you think starting the roadshow as you go to the all the parts of India and the colleges, like, why did you think it was important to start this?
Because I feel, Lakshit, unfortunately in our country, I feel that young people have a lot to say, but I don't think we listen enough.
Okay.
I don't think as adults and as the founders and CEOs and managers and business owners of companies, I don't think we listen to young people enough. Everybody wants to create content for young people. Everybody wants to create products that are marketed at young people. But do we truly understand what young people are going through and what their issues are, mm-hmm. and what solutions do they need, or how do they need any kind of guidance or mentorship, or what do they want out of their lives? Mm-hmm. I don't think we do enough of that. And I kind of feel really sad about that, because I feel like, we are one of the youngest countries in the world. We are 65% of our country is under 35, out of which 50% is under 25. You know, that's, we are the largest youth workforce in the world today. There are so many young, there are more Gen Zs in India than there are anywhere else in the world. Mm-hmm. And do we really understand? That's my big question. I don't think I don't think we do. I don't think all the people who are doing all these various jobs truly do understand young people. And I wanted to make sure that as a company, if you're calling ourselves Yuva, if you're caring about the issues of young people, we must first listen to them, understand what their issues are, and then make any kind of content and then find any solutions or any kind of partnerships that help address these issues. I don't want to just talk to young people. I want to listen first. I want to have a two-way conversation, because why would I else call my company UI? I could have done anything else in the world.
Yeah. Okay, great. Wonderful. And what kind of response have you been getting from the youths, from the youth side? What has been the response from the youth?
Do you follow UI?
Yes, I do, but not that constantly, because to be truthful, I just got to know Yuva very, very a little back time. And then I'm like, from that time, I'm just busy making this podcast episode. So, I did not really seen, but some yes, I have.
Okay, so what is your response for someone who's seen it very less? What do you think about Yuva?
I have seen, I think, three videos where a boy was telling he's a bisexual, and what he was talking about his experience, how his boyfriend wanted to agree and all those things. I think that was one video. Sure. That was one video I remember. Another, there was a girl who I really don't remember that one. I think she was going under some stress or something. I don't know. I don't remember that thing. But I just remembered that boy, because that was the first video I watched the video of Yuva.
Yeah, but what do you think about Yuva? Because you are asking me what is the response by young people, so I want to know your response as a young person. What do you think of the work we do? Do you like it?
I think I love it, because you're able to talk to youngsters first. There are a lot of people who don't want to speak about themselves out, and others, you're bringing other youngsters speaking their story, and there is someone who's, you know, feeling the same, and there is going through same emotions, and is able to, you know, not expressing himself, but able to understand the problem, and is able to understand that there are people who are having same problems and just have to, you know, be okay and find some solutions for that. And I think that's wonderful thing you as a company are doing.
Thank you, Lakshit. And honestly, that has been the response. You know, the only challenge is, of course, scale is that there are so many different, you know, we are still young in that sense. We are not a very old company. So we have about 75,000 followers right now. The number is going to increase slowly, steadily. Hopefully more people will come to know of us. Hopefully we'll do more roadshows. We'll do more sessions. We'll talk to more young people. And if every one of the young people have the response that you had, that would be success for us. But yeah, by and large, everyone's been really kind. I'm so glad that people trust us. People share their stories with us. You know, and I realize that. I think that there is, you know, young people, if you give young people the respect of being heard, you know, I think they give you a lot of love and a lot of compassion, and they cheer for you. They become your cheerleaders, you know. So I am very, very fortunate to have, you know, met such people and who have been kind to us. And I hope I can continue on that front.
Okay. And what kind of, you know, are there some people coming to you and telling that Nikhil, you're doing a great job, and just say something to you which, you know, makes you emotional? Have been some situations like that with you?
You know, for me, while of course, you know, people are very kind. Honestly, I'll be honest. I think I get a lot of DMs every once in a while that makes me very happy. Where people say that when you came that day on the roadshow, you said something that I still remember, or after that day, my relationship with my parents have improved, I saw your video and it really helped me with my family. So those are the moments that I really like, you know. Honestly speaking, for me, I think any kind of, if there are young people who reach out and say that you know, anything that we have done as you are has helped them in their life, that has impacted them in some way, I feel very grateful. I think more than emotion, it is a lot of gratitude. It makes me feel like the work that I do has meaning, and I want to continue doing this work because I want to make sure that hopefully there are more such people who can feel this way. And that's really the aim is to make young people feel less alone. Mm-hmm. To help them in their lives.
Okay.
You know, I have had a young person, we've had beautiful sessions where there's a young person in one session who decided to come out to the whole class and say that he was bisexual during a session we did. There was a guy who ended up telling his parents, confessing to his parents about being sexually assaulted because of a session, you know, and then finding a lot of love and empathy from his parents. There is a lot of the same boy whose story you saw, the video that you saw, his name is Mohit. Okay. You know, his mother started accepting him more after the video came out, you know. So I and that for me makes me really emotional, because I see that there is genuine, you know, I think there's power in storytelling and content to change the world, you know, in genuinely changing the world. And that's what we're trying to do. You know, we're trying to listen to and share those stories that make the world a better place, you know, and I think that some of that we are doing at a very, at a small way right now. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm very grateful, I would say, more than emotional, every time something like this happens.
Okay. And how as in a company, which a media company, which is on, based on the stories of youngsters, how would you create awareness and bring positivity, like create more awareness that the youth of this country matters, and what ideas, what thoughts they have is important to us, and how would you create that kind of awareness?
So, you know, I mean, really the whole company has been started to do this. So everything we do as Yuva is aimed at creating this awareness. So for example, we have a partnership with Instagram India right now. So the roadshow that he went on is partnered with Instagram India, where we have created safe spaces for young people, where we are where we are helping. Instagram is very kind for us in making sure that there are safe spaces that are being created, where we are having important conversations about gender, about patriarchy, about mental health, about examination stress and whatnot. There are offline ways. Online, we do a lot of campaigns. We do a lot of, again, partnership. We partner with some very interesting brands on doing campaigns offline and trying to create again, better, making sure that all the conversations that are happening with a sense of empathy. You know, they're happening with a sense of, instead of pushing people away and saying, you don't know, so you're an idiot. It's about, even if you don't know, that's okay. If you're willing to learn, we are the platform for you. We'll help you. We want to include you in the conversation. That's always been the philosophy. I don't think that if anybody doesn't understand certain issues, we don't judge them. We don't think that people who don't understand should be judged. We think that we should help them understand. We should try and include them in the conversation, and we should empower them, and help them become a better versions of themselves in some way. And that's really been the approach so far. So whether it is online, whether it is offline, we are doing now fellowships. We are doing all kinds of different things to make sure that we're tying up with universities, we're tying up with brands in different ways. At some point, I want to tie up with the education sector as well, in some way, just to make sure that we are with the sole aim of uplifting the lives of young people.
Okay. And, a normal question I want to ask to you is, when 10 years, 20 years pass away, when your body would become a bit, less, less faster than you are right now, how would you keep yourself updated? How would you keep yourself going on your mission, which you are thinking on right now?
I don't feel that, one must go on at all points in life. I think sometimes you also pause. So for me, I don't even think in that way. I always think that maybe 20 years down the line, I would just like to pause. I don't think in terms of success, failure. I don't think in terms of, how much I can do, how much I can achieve. I always think in terms of, where all I can contribute and what are the different ways in which I can contribute. Like, for example, even when I was teaching a class of, for example, 50 students, mm-hmm. I think that for me, that is just as valuable mm-hmm. as doing 100 colleges across the country, and meeting 10,000 young people. And it is just as valuable as having a good conversation with you. I don't think that numbers and statistics are really the measure of how fast and long and hard you can go at things. So I'm absolutely okay with not having to go on in 20 years. Ideally I would love if I'm able to do a good job and create a company that in itself can continue creating impact. I would love my time to be spent perhaps again teaching, but again, learning something, again, spending time with my children, hopefully at that point of time, seeing them grow, maybe writing a book, or just doing things that just bring me joy at that time. Yeah. So I don't have any metric of mujhe itna successful banna, mujhe itne paise banane. Mujhe wahi karna life ke andar jo mujhe that is making me happy.
Happy.
That is giving me joy and that is making me feel like this fulfillment in my life.
Okay. And when we come to social media, there are every time who are, just making fun or trolling you. So are there any people doing such kind of things also on the page, or, are there some kind of things, criticizing?
Always.
Okay. You also have those, you are helping youngsters themselves, but anyway, you also have trollers. Okay.
Yes, absolutely. Everywhere. I think what happens is that on the internet, we don't understand emotion.
Okay.
When you see, if I write something on the internet, people don't read it as thinking that there is a human being, behind this. They are always looking at just words. They're only looking at the handle name. My handle name on Instagram is Taneja Mehu. If somebody is typing something mean or trolling me, what they're doing is they're trolling that username. I don't think they recognize that, you know, there is a human being behind that username whose feelings are getting hurt. I don't think people, a lot of people think in that way. You know, because you create a podcast, so you understand the effort it takes to put out content or put out art. Yeah. I don't think people generally kind of understand that, you know, because they are not themselves in the shoes of the people who have written or done something or created something or made some effort, you know. So so a lot of the people sometimes just do it not with, I would say, malice or anger, but just because they don't understand how to talk or they don't count for the feelings of the people on the other side. So I'm always empathetic. I'm never mean to anybody on the net. I don't troll back. I don't, say unkind things in return. I don't make fun of them. I don't judge them. Because if I judge them and they have judged me, then we're the same people. Yeah. So I don't want to be that person. I always try and talk with kindness. But if somebody then becomes abusive or becomes, then I know that, you know, this is not a conversation I want to do. So I just don't respond any further.
Okay. Wonderful. Yeah. And what kind of things have you experienced? You know, what kind of things are coming your way? So how you are keeping yourself, you know, updated, and how you're keeping yourself learning every day from, you know, listening to journeys of people, listening to stories of people, reading different kind of things. How are you keeping yourself learning, you know, back to back? How are you doing that?
You know, so again, a lot of my learning comes from human interaction. You know, I prefer a lot of my learning coming from listening to the stories of people, listening to, you know, what they have to say through empathy, through feeling perhaps what they're feeling and going through, versus, kind of making concrete steps, for example, to do more degrees or doing distance learning courses. While, of course, knowledge is important. I read a lot of articles. I spend a lot of time on Twitter. There are some fabulous articles over there. So I try and read them and try and, learn as much as I can. I keep myself updated through the social media pages, through long form articles. I don't trust, TV news in our country. I think there's just a lot of noise over there. But yeah, I think most of my understanding and learning comes from just meeting more people, listening to them, and being empathetic. I think you can learn so much more if you're empathetic to people than through anything else in the world, honestly.
I do agree. Like with me also, it has been the same thing, that I am trying to, like, if I be truth, I was just a kid when I just, you know, started my podcast. I knew nothing. I just started, like, with some thought. I was inspired by Jay Shetty. I just, like, why not to do something like him? I just started doing that. And when I started doing podcasts back to back, like now, as we can't go out, I just thought of why not to do podcasts from Zoom, and which gives an not that wonderful quality or something, but I think it's something to learn from, and we can just connect with wonderful people. So I, like, literally there are a lot of things I learned just doing podcasts, you know, about veganism. For the second episode I did was on veganism, and I have never, like, till now I have never searched what is veganism on internet. And I just did an episode on vegan activist, and totally got to know how veganism works, you know. So that's, I think, we should.
Glad you're doing this. I think it's such a great great thought and great idea, and you're putting yourself out there.
Thank you.
And this is always the best way to learn, you know. Just listen to others.
Yeah. I think when you listen to others, people talking about their story, talking about something, it's more. There's some more to learn than just, you know, reading an article or reading something about that. Articles are helpful, but listening to someone and about the topic is more wonderful, I feel. Okay. And now, how does the business model works at UA? Like, how does the business model works?
So a lot of the business comes, I mean, we partner with brands, you know, so brands and organizations and nonprofits and different companies, even platforms, social media platforms, we, as I said, we look at finding solutions to problems. So we work with brands in trying to understand what the problems are, and then kind of working towards a solution. So since we understand young people a lot, we try and bring the issues of young people to brands, and then work with them on creating solutions for them. and then they pay for those solutions because we are putting our insight and our consultancy as part of it. Those are the ways that we kind of go about. And most of the companies always, you know, because if you're not a consumer, if you're not a company that has, you know, where the customer, for example, or the consumer is paying, then it's typically partnerships with bigger organizations and brands and companies that kind of pays for it.
Okay. So how what would be a special message to anybody watching this or anybody watching this? What would be a special message to them?
My message is always simple. It's always be kind. I think that there are enough angry, people in the world, people who don't understand other people, people who are unkind to other people, people who are mean. There's a lot of hate online. There's a lot of judgment, a lot of trolling, even offline. I think young people have so much they want to say, but I don't think that we allow them to have safe spaces where they can express themselves. So I think it's very important. I think everybody in the world is going through something we don't know about, yeah. You know, and so it's just so terribly important to be kind to people, and I think it's not a radical idea, but you know, in today's world, it is radical. I think empathy is radical. I think kindness is radical. And if you are kind, you're actually the coolest person possible because you're making people feel safe. You're making people feel good about themselves. You're making their day by just kindness. So yeah, that's always my advice to everyone. Be kind. Looking at what you are doing, I would also just say, believe in yourself and go for whatever you are trying for. Your age should not be a deterrent, yeah, in deciding what you want to do in life. Yeah. You know, just because you're young doesn't mean that you can't do certain things or you can't have a certain opinion or you can't think in a certain way. Of course, so I hope more young people like are at your age trying new things and trying being different, and putting themselves out there. I think that's just so amazing to see.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure, wonderful. It brings us at an end. It was wonderful having you. A totally unique kind of session. I was just feeling that we are just two friends and doing a Zoom call and we're just speaking. I did not even see the time. I just checked. It's been a long time and we're doing this. So yeah, thank you very much for being here. Pleasure having you. Thank you very much.